Moving to the next collection, we're going to discuss in this tutorial the interval collection class. Now, what interval is doing is actually very simple to explain. It creates a collection of numbers that have a sequence, a range of numbers. For example, let's say that we want to create a range of numbers starting from 1 and ending to 100. In order to do this, we use the name of the class and we call the method, the class method from2. So in this case, we say interval from 1 to 100. And if we do this and inspect it, we see that it creates an interval from 1 to 100. And we see in index 1 is the value 1. In index 2 is the value 2, in index 3 the value 3, and of course it ends at 100 with the value 100. Now, a quicker way to create this is by sending a message to a number. In this case, the next message is 2. So 1 to 100 is going to do the same thing as we did here. Let's do this. And expect it, and it does exactly the same thing. If we want to create a range of numbers by following a specific step, so in this case, when we create 1 to 100, the step is 1, so it adds a new number by stepping by adding a 1 to it. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In this case, 1 to 100, we use this method to by, and by we define here the step. The step is 0.5, so that means that it's going to create an interval that is going to look exactly like this, do it, and inspect. And it is 1, 1.5, 3, 3, sorry, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, and it is, of course, here 900 to 99.5 to 100 exactly. We can also do the same thing with our negative numbers. This is how we do it, 1 to minus 100, and the step is minus 1. So we do this and inspect again. We see here that it's 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2, etc. And if we want to do the opposite thing, minus 100 to 1 is going to do it like this, as we have explained earlier on. A very useful method we can actually use to find the size of any collection, not just the interval, is use the size method. So if we print this, it says to us it's 102, and it's 102 because it includes 0 and 1 inside. So it's 1 to 100, which is 100 numbers. 0 and 1 is, of course, another two numbers, and we have 102 in size. Now, by taking a look at this class, it may not look very impressive. I mean, it's not really, you don't have many uses in the cases of created ranges of number in order to populate collections. So one may ask why we need interval. What is the real usefulness of it? And a very important use for interval is for doing repetitive action. If you are coming from other languages, you know this kind of process as loops. But if you are new to coding, what it means is that I repeat the same action or slightly different action every time. Because I don't want to write the same code again and again and again, what I create is a repeat action. Let me give you an example. Let's say that I want to type into transcript 10 times, and each time I want to type this is time 1, this is time 2, this is time 3, this is time 4, until it reaches time 10. And I don't want to send 10 different transcript show messages. How I can do this? Well, let's execute this code here. do it, and let's open a transcript and see what happens. Okay, do it again. And you just see, this is time one, this is time two, this is time three, this is time four, etc., etc. So what have we done here? Well, the first thing is that we come creating an interval. And then we have sent the message do. Now, what the message do is doing is very similar to the message select and reject we have used early on for order collections. What it does, it takes each value of the interval, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it starts with 1 and passes 1 as a value to the first parameter you have assigned here for our block. So we pass a block and we assign a first parameter to it, which is time in this case. Now, this is passed the value 1. It executes the code in the block. Now, this is a regular transcript show message with a cascade that sends another message, which is the CR message, which is the card to return, which basically means go to the next line. So here it goes to the next line by using the CR command, the CR message. And we have this argument here for show message, which is this is time, which is the text. And the comma here means unite this text with this text. So what we have done here is we have taken time. So in this case, in the case of one, time is one. So it passes one here and sends the message as string. So it converts one to a string. And then using the comma message here, it unites the string with the string here. So this is time one. Because if we try to unite a number to a string, it's going to give us an error. So we need to convert this number to a string. Now, when it finishes this, it goes to the next value of the interval. So in this case, it's 2. It does the same thing. It passes 2 to time. It executes the message again here. It converts 2 to a string. So it converts it to a string and unites 2 to this is time. So we see 2 here. And the process repeats for 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, and 10. So this is actually a very convenient way to do repetitive action or to do loops, for loops for people coming from other programming languages. You're going to observe that Smalltalk and Faro do not really have for loops. It's not a language construct. And this gives us a flexibility of how to do repetitive action in very different ways depending on the situation. But we're going to talk about loops and repetition and doing repetitive things and iteration and other kind of stuff that has to do with repeating code again and again, slightly different, in a later tutorial. I mentioned this because I wanted you to know that intervals are actually very important, even though they may look limited, they're actually very important for FAR and for coding. And this is for this tutorial. See you on the next tutorial.